Brian, Janet Yellen, set to be the next Treasury Secretary, is proposing a $1.9 trillion relief package. She has been quoted as saying that we need to act big. Has the market already priced this in?
We don't think the market has priced in completely this $1.9 trillion package. In fact, we actually think it could go bigger, principally because the package that both Mr. Biden and Ms. Yellen are speaking about is really centered on COVID and COVID only. I think there's a very good likelihood that it could be bigger based on additional spending and help with respect to small business or infrastructure or further PPP, even relative to what's happening in COVID. And so I think Ms. Yellen's a background with respect to being a longtime Fed governor and, of course, head of the Fed is going to really help in terms of this relationship between fiscal stimulus and monetary stimulus in terms of the communication. I think maybe, if anything, investors could be potentially undershooting that, meaning not understanding how important that relationship is.
There is a lot of optimism with respect to vaccine rollouts, fiscal stimulus. There is this notion that people are sitting on a lot of cash and that'll lend itself to consumer spending. Has the market taken into account all these what ifs?
The period of what ifs continues on from 2020. And I think the biggest issue that we've been talking to clients about, and actually wrote about this in our year ahead piece that we published in November, and when we talked about forecasts for 2021, was that 2021 was not going to be this clear cut, perfect expectation of return to normalcy. It's going to take time. Human nature experienced some trauma last year, and we have some PTSD that we have to continue to work through. So believe it or not, and we know that, to be sure, it is wonderful news with respect to the vaccines, and we're probably going to get at least two or three more. I think people underscore the importance of what we've seen in terms of therapeutics. We're going to see more in terms of the rollout. I think people have been too critical in terms of this rollout. I mean, it takes time to understand how to do this. And so, again, I think this return to normalcy is going to be a process. It's not just 2021. It's going to be rolling well into 2022, we believe. And because of that, there's going to be some expectations that are not going to be met. And I think that could cause some volatility with respect to equity markets. But in terms of this whole notion of a lot of money on the sidelines, we had outflows from equities in terms of Canadian equities to record levels of outflows in 2020. That tells me that people are still negative equities. And that actually makes me more positive, because we like to look at things on a more contrarian basis.
The policies of the outgoing U.S. administration seem to favor a lower dollar, lower interest rates, lower tax rates. With the policies of this new administration, is this going to take the air out of the markets?
I don't know what the previous administration was necessarily lower dollar. It was in terms of the tactics with respect to dealing with the trauma of COVID-19 coronavirus. I think traditionally you see Democratic presidencies and administrations even more dovish. And as you know, Janet Yellen was even more dovish than Bernanke. But I will say this, I think the timing and the what ifs of additional taxes or new taxes, or what that looks like in terms of both taxation and regulation, might be something that the market's gonna grapple with the second half of the year. But I do think it's pretty clear that the primary focus of the new administration is going to be COVID. And that's why there's been so much talk in terms of a potential lockdown, which we think could happen on a national basis, or at least a regional lockdown or rolling lockdown. But Mr. Biden is already advising that he's going to put forward a national mask mandate. And so I think that they're trying, and they're going to be doing much different things than what the prior administration was doing.
We saw that technology controlled the market in 2020. Where do you see growth this year? Who are going to be the drivers on both sides of the divide? I've read your reports, and financials seems to dominate that list again.
You know, the market needs financials. In the old days, a decade or so ago, the market couldn't go up without financials. Now, recently, we've seen the market can't go up without technology. You know, our call is that we're going to see more diversified performance across the majority of sectors, majority of asset classes, majority of styles. I think it's very hard to make a growth versus value call That's why we're more neutral. I think at the end of the year, value will outperform. But I think we're going to have a period where growth has another big spike, especially if and when we have a lockdown and a move back into the stay-at-home stocks. We want to be more diversified. And from a small, mid, and large cap basis, we're doing that in terms of size and style in the United States. We think technology is not as negative as everybody thinks. You should be maintaining your positions in technology, not aggressively adding or not aggressively selling, but maintain those big core positions. Same thing with the communication services sector in the United States. If you think about where the consumer's spending, we are spending on content, right? We're sitting around watching Netflix or sitting around watching Disney. Or we're buying new Apple products and new operating systems. So we're still going to spend the money there, Larysa, but I think those are the names that you want to continue to be in with respect to the power and strength of the consumer for the next 3 to 5 years.
There seems to be this notion when it comes to U.S.-Canada trade relations that this new administration will be, I guess, more favorable. But first up on the list, I guess, for President Biden will be scrapping this Keystone XL project. And I'm wondering what that will ultimately do to Canadian oil stocks.
Well, we think Canadian oil stocks and energy stocks are actually better positioned than U.S. energy stocks. And U.S. oil and U.S. energy stocks need a higher price of oil. We've had a nice pop in oil here, but much of that we believe was more of a momentum and short covering type of move. We think actually U.S. and oil stocks should be sold. We'd much rather buy Canadian energy stocks because of the management teams, because of the cash levels, because of the products and services that you Canadian oil and energy companies do. With respect to the Keystone pipeline, I think obviously that could be a near-term negative. But again, in terms of the capacity of where oil is internationally and the impact is certainly on U.S. stocks, I think it's more of a negative impact on U.S. energy than it is Canadian energy.
I'm curious to get your thoughts on renewable energy.
We're bullish renewable energy, especially on the utility side. Okay, so there are great companies in Canada and the United States that look at that. If you think about some of the renewable energy research that has been done with the traditional oil companies, don't underestimate how much CNQ and Suncor and Trap and Enbridge have been spending and learning more about renewable energy over the last several years. That has followed suit with what we've seen in the United States for some of the big utilities. Like NextEra and XL Energy and Duke and even Exxon and Chevron. So I think that's the way you kind of want to play those areas in terms of renewable energy. It's here to stay, and it's obviously a more efficient way of looking at things. But don't necessarily sell the big oil companies in Canada because you automatically think they're not involved with renewable energy.